Hey guys, Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. John, can you just grab the music, turn the music down right now?
Sure.
Thank you so much. I want to thank everybody for joining my weekly webinar. We're going to mix things up a little bit today. If you have not seen the last 48 hours of the work we're doing, I'm looking at the wrong camera here. Multi-camera shot here. We're doing some great stuff over here at Solid Canine Training. My name is Jeff Gellman. My company is Solid Canine Training. We're a real-world dog training company. We're a working kennel. We specialize in a lot of aggression rehab. So Cameron right now is going to play two videos for you. The first video is the day the dog came in. This dog came in on Monday. Today is Wednesday. On Monday, the dog came in. He's got human and dog aggression as well as cage aggression, high-level resource guarding, and doesn't know any commands. Now the dog is 8 years old. So what that means is the dog has had 8 years of practice. Does that make sense? The dog's been practicing this bad behavior for 8 years. So bear with us right now. We're going to do a screen share, and we're going to run two videos. But after that, I'm going to show you how we're doing our food protocols. All right? So go ahead, Cameron. That was the first one. 24 hours later, this is how we're getting him out of the kennel now. Scroll down. We got it. Good. So this is the protocol from this morning now. Hey guys, it's Jeff. This is recorded specifically for the webinar that's going on now. I just want to show you how the progress we're making getting Deuce out of his kennel, and then we're going to incorporate this into our weekly live webinar that we're doing today. So what we're doing is, we've all seen how he was when I'm going to post the crate, obviously intense. So what we're doing now is, we got him, we keep him on a long line. So he's better, right? If a little bit of a grovel, I'm going to let it go now, right now. Open up the door. Let's go. Good boy. Good job, buddy. That's the progress, guys. Good stuff. Come on. Come on. Good job. Now when I go put it back in, see what we got. Because this is also a popular time for these guys to aggress towards us. Much better. They'll be in love with you guys. Thanks for sharing. So happy I can do this for you. And obviously for the dogs. All right, take care.
Back to Google Hangout. Get out of screen share. Okay, good. All right.
So can folks just write in their chat boxes if you saw that? All right, make sure you saw that, and let's make sure that the video and my mic levels are good. So again, thank you so much for doing that. If you missed any part of that, if you just joined in right now, the webinar gets uploaded to YouTube, and it will be posted on my Facebook page. So don't worry about that. Now what we're going to do is we're going to do the food protocols on how we're feeding the dog. And this is the theory what we do with dogs like this. What do you do with a high-level resource guarder? The only time we're going to feed this dog is when he's working for us. So for the first 24 hours, there was no feeding whatsoever. We couldn't get next to him. So now we started to muzzle condition him. We need to be able to get a muzzle on the dog. So we're going to show you our muzzle conditioning protocols right now. Is that someone saying that they're hearing us okay? Because we need interaction. Good, good. Thank you guys so much for your input. That's wonderful. So with the help of John, I'm going to show you how we're doing our muzzle protocols. So John, will you bring the dog over? So, and then go out of the way. So John has him on a back tie. Let's see how he does this. Come on. Come on. It's actually the wrong spot. Gosh. Come on.
Want to go with that?
Yep. Come on. going to change where I am. We still on screen? Okay, good. So why do I put this leash down here? This helps me have a defined line where the dog can't reach. So if he lunges at me, I know he can't reach past that. So this is what we're going to do. This is the muzzle that he'll be trained on. It's a Jacko muzzle. We love Jacko muzzles. I'm going to be putting some of his food in the muzzle. Now, he knows the food is there, right? He knows it's there. Guess what? He can't get to that food. Uncle Jeff gets him the food, correct? So what we're going to do now is, here's the food, muzzle. A little bit too fast. Muzzle. I really wanted to start digging into this. Muzzle. Good. The reason why I wanted to start digging into it is by the end of the day today, what we'll be doing is we'll be getting the straps over the head. Now, it's not as easy as you think. Getting straps over the head, it's a really invasive thing for a dog like this. It's a great time for them to snap. Okay? Muzzle. So he knows that he can't reach it, and he knows that he needs me. Muzzle. So I'm going to start, eventually what I'm going to start doing also is trying to give him physical touch on the top of his head. What I'm looking to, I actually want him to drive into this muzzle. So I want him to drive into this muzzle. Muzzle. Jeez, you gotta be kidding me. Highly distracted. Muzzle. Good. Can you get mouth safe? So now we've got to get them off the, we got to get them off the carabiner. So this is the part that's a little bit sketchy. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get his, see if I can get his attention. And John's going to pick up the black leash. And he's going to get the carabiner off of that. Great, thank you, John.
Yep. All right.
We already have some questions.
Get the, yeah, all set.
Okay.
So, questions.
What are we feeding him? And is that what he usually eats at home?
Yeah, so what it is the owners brought the food. It's a home-cooked meal of turkey and rice and vegetables. We find a lot that there's a correlation. A lot of times, a lot of dogs that struggle with a lot of aggression issues also have really fancier food that they're given instead of just kibble. So that doesn't mean the kibbles, the fancy food's making them aggressive, but what it means is no knock on the clients at all. But the state of mind, we should be focusing on the dog's behavior and state of mind, not as much as on if they're eating certain foods. But I'm a big advocate of diet. I'm a big advocate of proper nutrition. I'm a big advocate of exercise. But what I want people to do is I want people to make sure that you address behavior. If you put just as much importance on behavior as you put on you're not going to have these issues. So where do we go? So where do we go from here? Now is a good time for you guys to ask any dog training question you want, because this webinar is for you. So a lot of folks have been, they wanted to ask me questions all week. It's hard for me to answer questions during the week by email or Facebook because of my busy schedule. So I offer these webinars as a free resource for all you dog owners out there, as well as my Saturday radio show. So if you've got dog training questions, right now is a really great time to get those questions out. You just type it in your chat box, and then we will receive them, and then Cameron will read them to me. So the food, though, what we're doing with our aggressive dogs is this, is we need to be able to get a muzzle on these guys, because they're a risk to us, and they're a risk to other dogs, and they're a risk to themselves, actually. So the first thing we need to do is to be able to get a muzzle on them. Without a muzzle, it's hard for us to do this work. So we really want to make sure that the dog is muzzled and is safe. There's other ways to put a muzzle on a dog. They're pretty invasive. You can, you know, hold the dog down. You could pin a dog to a wall. You can pin a dog to a floor. You can pin a dog up to a fence. And then you can have another person put the muzzle on. The goal of the muzzle conditioning, though, is to get a dog to want to put the muzzle on and to be excited about putting the muzzle on. So that's what we are doing, is be excited about putting that muzzle on, and they want to put the muzzle on. That way then, we'll hold it up. The next step is, there's no back tie. The reason why we do a back tie, if that dog lunges, I can just sit there and I cannot move. Historically, when a dog lunges at you and you move back, the dog says, hey, look at that, I'm a pretty powerful animal here. I got that human to move me back. So the next step would be, the dog's not on the back tie, the dog will sit, I put down the muzzle, I will say muzzle, the dog will drive into the muzzle. We can also do some physical touch on the top of the dog's head. You saw a couple of times, I tried to do physical touch on the dog's head, the dog went like this. So it's important, you know, I got plenty of dogs that we can just put a muzzle on and strap them. Tons of dogs we can do that. They would never aggress towards you. So it's important to understand, a lot of, whether it's dog owners or dog trainers, there's different levels of behavior in a dog. And a lot of times, folks, this is the hard part about what I do. A lot of dogs that come into our training facility would never make it in most homes. So the training protocols we do to rehabilitate them sometimes don't make sense. And that's not a knock at anybody's intelligence. But I've never had a bedridden child or a bedridden uncle or aunt. I have no idea. I have absolutely no idea the stress and the anxiety and the money and the work it takes to care for somebody that's in bed. I have no idea what it's like to change a bedpan or change a diaper on an adult or to be exhausted from the home care of an adult. So I really can't comment on those things. It's the same thing with dog training. Unless you're working with dogs that are actually dangerous to you, some stuff is hard to understand. And I commend the owners. A lot of times people were like, well, aren't the owners responsible? Absolutely. The owners are definitely have a responsibility part in this. But keep in mind, the dog's 8 years old. It's had 8 years of practicing that bad behavior. Why didn't the owners get help earlier? That's a great question. They might have tried to get help earlier, but there's a lot of dog trainers, there's a lot of dog trainers out there that give out really bad advice. They give out advice that doesn't work, or the owner doesn't follow through with the advice. So it's a lot of different things. And I love the fact that the dog is here, and I love the fact that we're able to help. I love the fact that we're actually able to make dramatic change in a dog's life and make change in an owner's life. One of the comments that people were making is when we were filming that video clip that you first saw is, well, that's because there's a camera in the dog's face. Absolutely 100% true. But I assure you, without that camera, the dog did it as well. So, but it's not the camera, and it's not my eye contact. It's the dog. The video clip you saw when the dog first came in, he did that 20 times every time we got close. It was very, very hard to get to get to that dog. All right, we have some questions?
Okay, yes. Great, thank you. How do you start with a 10-year-old puppy and introduce 10-week-old puppy and introduce him to prong and e-collar?
Okay, so excellent question. What's the person's name?
Andrew.
Andrew?
Andrea.
Andrea. Great question, Andrea. I wouldn't put a 10-week-old puppy on prong or e-collar, but I would start setting them up knowing that I wanted my dog off-leash trained. What I would do now is have intense structure. So with my 10-week-old puppies, this is what I want. I'm going to need some water soon, too. We'd like to thank you. Thank you, Cameron. Thank you. This is what I want with my 10-week-old puppies. Wait for food. Did you see how I did the waiting for food, even in the muzzle? So waiting for food. The dog does not move towards me. I do not say sit. I do not say stay. I hold the food bowl up. I'm not going to fit you on this. I hold the food bowl up. I put the food bowl down. The dog rushes toward food. I would pick the food bowl up again. I put the food bowl down. As soon as the dog goes like this, I would say break. In and out of the kennel. Kennel up. Open the door. The dog's not allowed to come out. Let's go. Kennel up. Let's go. I want the dog to go in and out of the kennel. I want the dog to wait for its food. I want to work out all my crate training protocols. I want the dog not to be jumping. No jumping at all. I will want to do confidence building exercise. What's confidence building exercise? A 10-week-old puppy should not be eating out of a food bowl, first of all. So, and I just was telling you how to do the food protocols. 10-week-old puppy should only eat when it works. So what do? Take the dog's kibble. I'm a big advocate of kibble. Have the dog sit, have the dog down, have the dog recall. Have the dog, the kibble, have the dog go under things, over things, through things. Have the dog walk on different surfaces. Set up a little jungle gym area in your backyard. So you can use one of those kids' jungle gyms where they, you know, go down slides and walk upstairs and walk on uneven surfaces. Get the dog used to different textures on its feet, different sounds. Let the dog be eating when there's fireworks, thunder going off. Okay? Food is a powerful motivator when it comes to puppies. So people think I don't do food training. I do. I use food a lot in training, not a ton, but I've been using it more and more. I like to experiment with different motivators to get the results that I want. Okay? So
Okay, next question is from Alex. When bringing the family back into the picture, how do you get them to let go of what the dog used to do as far as aggressive towards them? I just sent home a dog after 5 weeks with him.
Yeah.
And the wife was very afraid, even though she saw the changes that the dog made.
Yeah. Alex, the hardest part about, out of total transparency, I love my clients. I'm actually madly in love with my clients. I respect them, and I also understand their struggle. The hardest part of our job, bottom line is this, a board and train is the best way to rehabilitate and train a dog, bottom line. In my opinion, remote collars are the best way to get an off-leash trained dog as well as to do behavior modification. The issue is, you're right, the families are struggling. They've got all these preconceived notions. So what we're going to start doing, the biggest, I constantly work on my craft. I go to dog training seminars, I watch videos, I read books, and I'm fortunate to have lots of dogs coming through here for rehabilitation and training. So I'm able to work with a lot of dogs. But our number one priority moving forward is client training for client success. Client training for client success. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be sending home personalized videos for our clients to watch what we're doing with the dogs. I need my clients to use the same words, the same cadence, the same tone as we do. So if they can start seeing their dog do stuff, but also having clients involved in the training. If it's a 5-week board and train, we want them here at the week 3, week 4, and week 5. Week 3 for an hour, week 4 for an hour, week 5 for 2 hours, and then include them in 3 more sessions afterwards for an hour each. Give them good leadership skills to learn. The thing is this, dogs regress, they're dogs. It's the way it is. But it takes the confidence to do it. So if you can start showing results, it's hard for a human, a dog owner, to feel good about their dog if they don't see success. That's why I'm such a cheerleader for balanced training. When somebody goes to a trainer and they can't get that dog to walk after 3, 4, 5, even sometimes 15 seconds, your average human is not going to keep up with it. They just won't. Dogs should be able to be walked down the leash usually in the first section, my opinion. And we do it every day. And I wouldn't say that if we couldn't do it. It doesn't take long to get a dog to walk properly on a leash. So the best thing you can do, Alex, is understand what the client is going through. And I know you, I'm sure you do. I've seen your posts. I know you're a fan. I really appreciate your involvement in my life. Get these clients involved in the process as quick as possible. Show them success. Always be there for them, but also hold them accountable. I try to hold them accountable without being disrespectful. I know I'm sure I come off as cold and uncaring sometimes to a client, as well as to the general population of the world. But I also know it works. I know what it takes to get a dog from aggressive to non-aggressive to obedient to off-leash trained. So, I'm there with you, buddy. I'm there with you.
What dog books do you recommend to understand the psychology of dogs?
I'm a huge fan of The Monks of Newski. A huge fan. Raising a Perfect Puppy is great. I would focus on a lot of The Monks of Newski and a lot of Cesar Millan stuff. If you don't like Cesar Millan, that's fine. If you don't like The Monks of Newski, that's fine. Read, though, their books so you better understand that they're dogs. They are not human beings. They absolutely are not humans. They're not fur babies. They're not little children. And puppies are also dogs. When you get a puppy, guys, you're not raising a puppy. You're actually raising a dog. So it's really, really important to understand. It's really important to understand. I can see a lot of people are just joining us now. What you missed was, if you follow me on Facebook, we got a dog in 2 days ago. It's incredibly human, dog aggressive, resource guarding. It doesn't know any obedience commands, and it's 8 years old. We showed 2 videos. One was the video when the dog first came in, and the next one was the one 24 hours later, and then we also just did a demo on how we're getting the dog to be muzzle conditioned. Right.
Next question is from Laura, who was here at the beginning. It has to do with muzzle training still.
Yes.
What training do you typically do before the dog is muzzle trained? How do you walk them without being bit? Do you use a catch pole?
Okay, so we have used catch poles in the past, and as you know, catch pole stress, if you don't know what a catch pole is, imagine like, you know, the classic dog catcher. It's a 4 or 6 foot stiff pole with a loop on the end. And what you do is when you've got a dog that doesn't want to come out of a crate or a dog that is trying to attack you, you actually can get the noose around the dog, you pull it tight, you actually can walk the dog with it. It stresses out the dog. But you have to get that dog moving. Okay, movement is key. Movement is key. That dog yet has not gone on a walk that we have. We've been like shit about it. We're taking the dog outside for walks in our private yard. We are walking the dog around our training facility, but the dog has not yet been off property for a walk. And it doesn't matter at this point. It absolutely does not matter at this point what if the dog is going for a walk yet. We need to be able to, we're using just a slip lead on the dog. So the dog is just on a basic slip lead. We are going, the next step is once we get that dog muzzled, we'll start using a training collar, we'll get a remote collar on that dog, and we'll off-leash train that dog. So, did I answer that question, Kevin?
You did.
Okay.
We should go back to the book question.
Yes. That's
kind of a follow-up.
Yep.
With the monks of what? How is it spelled?
The monks of New Skeet, S-K-E-T-E. Brother Christopher, he's a friend of mine, and they've got a great facility in upstate New York, and you can go actually visit them. They've got a lot of videos and they've got a lot of books out. There's about, I think they've got 6 or 7 books out that they've got now, and they've got a really great philosophy. The way they raise puppies, though, incredible. Incredible the way they raise puppies.
Okay, the next question is from Melissa. How do you handle a 5-month-old who is showing dog reactivity outside the home, focused, growling, and lunging? I do basic obedience with him, but that goes out the window when I change direction.
I know.
He turns and remains focused.
Okay.
Should I introduce an e-collar?
Okay, yes. Okay, so this is what you're going to do. We want to get a handle. Melissa?
Yes,
okay.
Melissa.
Melissa, awesome question. Thank you so much for participating. We want to get the dog to start. We got to get a handle on this now because it's going to get worse before it gets better. The concept is this. If you're focused on me, then you're not focused on anyone else. You're focused on me, you're not afraid of me. I want you to know what I'm up to. So how do you get that? Distractions are distractions. So obviously when you've got a dog that's distracted, so if I'm healing a dog and the dog's looking straight and all of a sudden the dog is looking like this, stop it. Keep the dog in a heel. But this is what's happening. Let me see if I can get a dog. Why don't you have John get girl or Shayla? Let me work with. She's taking them for a walk. Let me just work with girl real quick. I'll show you some techniques to do. We did this in the last webinar, and we'll do it again in this webinar, just to show you some techniques. Everybody waits though till the dog is too far ahead. I want you to give that dog information way further. So I'm going to show you a couple of techniques. Remote collar training is great. Remote collar training really gets a dog to be focused on you. If you're not familiar with remote collar training, there is no shocking or zapping involved. It does not make the dog afraid. It does not make the dog aggressive. There's a lot of other ways to make dogs afraid and aggressive, most of it being with your own human hands. So, you know, remote collar is used responsibly, and this argument that they can be used irresponsibly, everything can be used irresponsibly, right? Food can be used irresponsibly, whether I'm rewarding at the wrong moments or I'm overfeeding my dog. Your hands can be used for petting. Your hands can also be used for punching. Your feet can be used for kicking, and your feet can be used for walking. So don't worry about any of that. All right, let's get a dog out here really quick. So I think I'm in the camera view. Okay, great. So, most people, I'm going to try to do this sort of in slow motion, most people will, they wait until their dog is too far ahead of them, and then they give it information, all right? What I want you to do, what you do is you do a couple of exercises with your dog, So this is a classic. If you're not a fan of Keeler, this is sort of like a little bit of a Keeler method here. It's a modified version of Keeler. I don't know. I'm not a Keeler trainer at all, and I don't know enough about it to speak, so this is not the Keeler method at all. But what I want you to do is, as soon as you start seeing your dog focused on something else, right, which the girl's not, I want you to turn. Sheila, I'll be able to do it for 2 minutes. You can take her. So say my dog was focused on something else, I turn and pop. Turn and pop. Focus on something else, turn, pop. I want you to do the pop. That pop on the turn, and it's hard for a girl because she's not doing it, but imagine if she was looking that way, I want her to, so she's looking that way. So I want you to catch her off guard, right? Okay, that's one method. Now, this concept, okay, that was not exactly it. I did a bigger video with a bigger lens, and girl was not the best candidate for that, but she was about to go out for a walk. This concept, though, that if your dog is looking at another dog, and if you give it information with a correction, the dog will think that the other dog is causing them harm. That does not happen. I want you to know that does not happen. I have never seen any fallout from that. I've trained thousands of dogs, and I've worked with a lot of leash-reactive dogs. So that's another thing, guys, when you're out there looking for, I don't know if that was helpful to Melissa.
She also, I mean, ask Austin if you recommended e-collar work for that.
Okay. E-collar, yeah, but learn how to use the e-collar first. What you shouldn't be doing is just, you know, quote-unquote, blasting your dog when it looks at another dog. You actually want to use lower levels to get your dog to fall into heel. My colleague Sean O'Shea does a great e-collar healing video. So look up Sean O'Shea, The Good Dog, e-collar video. He does an incredible e-collar video on you can actually heal your dog with a remote collar. If you're not a fan of a remote collar, I want folks to know, remote collars are not for if nothing else worked, or they're not for aggressive dogs. E-collars are for training dogs. Training dogs. They're for training all dogs, all breeds, all temperaments. The argument is, and the argument in the discussion, I'm well aware of all the discussions out there, guys, is, well, there's other ways to train it. I know there's other ways to train it. Of course there is. There's always other ways to train a dog. But I love using e-collars. So I use remote collars. I use prong collars. I use food. I use a slip lead. But if I want a truly off-leash reliable dog, I'm going to use the tool that works. But also here's another thing. To my fellow dog trainers out there, just because we can train a dog without a remote collar, that doesn't mean our clients can. It just doesn't. And what we should, I can train a dog with a piece of string, but why would I when I've got tools that I've got access to? And my clients, though, when I've got a client that's not a dog trainer, I need to be able to use a tool on the dog that the client then could use. And you know, the argument always goes with my colleagues, well, if you train the dog well enough, the client should be able to duplicate it. It's a lie. It's a lie. I'm not making robots. You know, I'm not making robots. I'm a family dog trainer. I'm a family dog trainer. And my clients have a different relationship with their dog than I do. If the dog doesn't believe the client can do something, the dog's not going to do it. We see that all the time. There's no failure on our part. We don't make robots, and we're not fixing a computer, and we're not fixing a car. They're dogs. And they acclimate a lot to their environments. If a dog sees a weak owner, they're going to take advantage of that. So yes, remote collar training for a dog that's not focused on the walk is an awesome tool. It's an awesome tool. I understand there's a lot of other methods. I'm not discounting those methods, but when you ask me, and I'm not arguing with me, but when someone asks me, yeah, remote collars are great. And someone's going to say, well, why don't you just redirect the dog with food? Because I don't want to redirect the dog with food. I want to use the tool that I love. So I love the remote collar. I love the conversation I can have with the dog. I love the ease of the use of it. I love the rapid pace that I can move the dog forward. So I just love it. I just love it. So yes, to answer your question.
Just a little reminder, we got about 20 minutes left, so you still have chances to bring in your questions to ask Jeff. The next question is for Gary, from Gary. I am buying a dog crate for my 12-month-old Belgian Shepherd. Mm-hmm. How do I go about training him?
Gary, what have you been waiting so long for is what I want to know. Come on, Gary. All right. Gary, what have you been doing for the last 12 months? That's a better question. Come on. You type me. I want to know. Has there been destruction? Has there been bad behavior? Has there been pacing back and forth? Has there been separation anxiety? All right, this is what we're going to do, Gary. Thank you, first of all, for crating your dog. I crate all my dogs. I'm a big advocate of the crate. I'm not an advocate of a dog destroying furniture and suffocating in plastic bags and jumping out windows and pacing back and forth and peeing and pooing on the ground. I know some people are not a big fan of crates. That's fine, but I got more than welcome to take into your homes and not crate them. We'll see how much of a fan you become of crates. So it's not mean, it's not abusive. This is what we do for crate protocols. Your dog should learn to go in the crate and come out of the crate on command. So go in the crate and come out of the crate on command. The dog should learn how to do a downstay in the crate. So let's do this. Let's not just put your dog in the crate and let the barrier of the crate keep the dog in there. This is when you're home. So I want you to kennel up your dog. So I use kennel up. Kennel up. Dog goes in. Down. Dog lies down. The door is open. So let's pretend that the crate is where the camera is, which is a little bit in front of me, and I will sit here. I'll read a book. I'll write love letters to my wife, which I do every day. A little hint to you guys out there and gals out there. Love letters to the loved ones. I will get some computer work done. I'll do some social media. And my dog is in its crate lying down. Guess what? The crate now becomes a calming exercise. Calming exercise. Okay. Close the door. No barking. No whining. How do you get a dog to not bark and whine in the crate? This is what you do. Hold the dog accountable. It's so important that we hold our dogs accountable for whining and barking. So I've got a great video out there on separation anxiety and how to prevent it and fix it. It's a 13-step video. It works for us. Is it the only way? No. Nothing I say is the only way, guys. So it's... These webinars and my training is sided with me. Of course it is. But I've tried a lot of different things. I've trained a lot of dogs. And I like to do what works. But I'm also willing and do change things up all the time. So getting the dog in and out of the crate. Is that Gary?
Nope, this is another question.
So I don't know if that answers your question, Gary, but you want to start treating the crate like it's an obedience exercise.
You also have a ton of YouTube videos on crate training.
Yeah.
This next question, forgive me, is from Yar. We have a pit bull that becomes aggressive towards other dogs on walks. Mm. We also have a wean, W-E-I-N.
Wein,
that puts the pit in her place.
Yeah.
What can we do to appropriately correct fear-based aggression on dogs?
Okay, well, number one.
Yair, by the way.
Okay, number one. Is your dog fighting with dogs? So please text that, write that in your chat box. Has your dog been off-leash with dogs and gotten into fights? Yes or no? Because if the answer is no, you don't have an aggressive dog. You have a leash-reactive dog. There is a huge difference. Just because dogs are aggressive on a leash, that doesn't mean they are aggressive dogs. I have some dogs that are, they go to daycare every day. They are the best players in the world. On a leash, they look like Cujo. Okay? You have a leash-reactive dog. So what I want you to do is train your dog how to walk properly on a leash. Use the tools that work. Prong collars work. The reason why your Weimaraner is correcting your dog is because you are not correcting your dog. So I don't want the Weimaraner to correct the dog. You should be correcting the dog. So let's do this first. Walk your pit separately. Teach your dog how to walk properly on a leash. use the tools that I suggest, which are prong collars or remote collars, but also my overall training philosophy.
Yes, the dog
has gotten into a fight. Yes. Okay. So just to let you know, though, dogs can be rehabilitated. I want you to know that. I want you to know that. But I'm not looking for your dog to be friends with dogs. I want your dog to be able to walk on a leash properly around other dogs, as well as cats and squirrels and people. And your dog doesn't have to interact with other dogs, but I also want you to know that we can socialize your dog so you can find someone around you that does dog socialization and does it well. It will advocate for your dog. Okay, next question.
This is from Debbie. What are your thoughts about where to locate?
Like in the home.
I'm believing it's location-wise.
Okay. I don't want my crates in my bedroom. My bedroom is for my spouse and I. Even if you're single, let's get the crate out of your bedroom. You can put the crate in a main area. If you've got a walkout basement, though, walkout basements are great for crates. But you can put it in your living room because you're going to use it for sometimes for household management. Sometimes you're going to want your dog in the crate just to do some downtime. I don't like crates in kitchens because the kitchen. I actually don't want your dog in the kitchen. So your main living area, that's where I want your crate to be. Also, on that note, dogs don't need to have the run of the house. They don't need to have the run of the house. Dogs pretty much just need one or two rooms. That's all they need. And if it's a young dog or a dog that has destructive behavior or soiling behavior, they should be really limited to one room.
Next question is from Gary.
Hey, Gary.
My Belgian Cube, and I've only had him for 6 months.
Okay.
I am changing my training protocol.
Okay.
Can it affect leash reactivity?
It depends what you change it to. I don't know. Can it affect it? I mean, okay. Gary, help me out. Write something longer. What did you used to do, and what did you want? What do you want to do? And was your dog? Is this the same Gary?
I only get first names.
Okay. So, if your dog is leash reactive now and you're changing your protocol, can you make it better? Absolutely, if you use the right protocols. So yes, you can. Remember, every dog, 100% of the dogs that come in here, if you guys follow me on Facebook, 100% of the dogs that come in here, if you see them behaving well on my videos, on my Facebook page, none of them did that when they came in here. So there's only been like two dogs in the last maybe 6 years, and maybe five dogs in the last 10 that we struggled with on the leash. And we're talking about thousands of dogs.
Gary's answer was yes.
So yes, you can make it better, Gary. Yes, you can make it better.
Okay, next one is from Julie. I have looked at your videos, and I've looked at your videos by you that actually shows the steps that you take to change the behavior of aggressive and dangerous dogs. I haven't been able to find any. Do you have any recommendations?
I recommend you try. This is what I want you to do, Julie. I don't think we have a step-by-step video on how to change a dog. I probably don't want people to do that at home either. This is what I want you to do, though. Do incredible, incredible foundation work with your dogs. So I want you to do incredible foundation work with your dogs. I want your dog to know every basic command at a high level. I want your dog to walk properly on a leash. I want your dog to go into its crate and come out of its crate on command. I want your dog to go into a crate, and I want no nonsense, no whining, no barking, nothing like that. I want your dog to have the bomb-proof recall. I want your dog to do a down from the place command for a long periods of time. What's a long period of time? 1 to 3 hours. That's not asking much for these dogs. I want your dog to learn how to be calm on command. How do we get calm on command? Everything I described.
Okay.
Hold your dog accountable. Does that make sense? Now, what do we got? What do we got? Dogs still getting into dog fights. Fine. I don't want you to fix that on your own. I don't want you to fix that on your own. Because I'm not going to give you dog fight, how to break up a dog fight or dog fighting advice through this thing, because I don't want to see you get hurt. But I want you to know it can be done. But here we go. Yesterday there was a picture of Tom. Tom's over from Europe. He's doing his one-week shadow program with me, and then he spent another week at a seminar with me. You saw him with a black dog on a leash named Max, and then you saw two or three of my other dogs, you saw him with a dressage whip. This dog does not like other dogs. Doing, he was keeping the other dogs away from the black dog. He was advocating for the black dog. So if you've got a dog that's dog aggressive, why are dogs dog aggressive? Because they think they have to or because they want to, but usually it's lack of leadership and guidance from their human. So his job was to keep the dogs away. Keep the dogs away. Okay. That's a start. How's that? That's a start.
Julie is actually mentioning this. She just wrote another comment. I want to learn because she helps at shelter dogs.
Yes. Okay. So if you're a shelter worker, this is what you need to do. You need to get up here for a seminar, or you need to bring me to you at a seminar. And both those options are expensive, but they're done. Shelters also, historically, shelters are not interested in the information that I have. Bottom line, they're not, and if you talk to any balance trainer out there, they don't want to hear it. They only want to hear about hugs, loves, and kisses. And I'm not saying this to be combative at all, and I'm not saying this to start a war, and I'm not saying this to talk down to anybody, but that's the truth. Now, if you have a rescue that's open to the tools, that's fine. But your average animal shelter could be doing a much better job if they understood basic dog obedience. And unfortunately, they don't, and the dogs are suffering. The dogs are suffering. So,
got a great question from Laura. When should you allow a dog to correct another dog? Do they need to establish an appendix? Pecking order, pack with you, or course being the leader?
Okay, so great question. So Girl is one of my sheriffs. And she corrects other dogs. But I got to be careful. I mean, if I only have one or two other dogs in the room, I can do it myself. If there's like 10 dogs in the room, I might need her help. Sometimes she pushes it too far. I've got to actually correct her. So I got to correct my sheriff. I prefer if you, the human, did it. But a good example is, say I've got five dogs off leash and I call them all back and one of them doesn't come back. Girl will run after that dog and give it a quick bite in the neck saying, pretty much, didn't you hear Jeff, get your butt back. You know, that's not the worst thing in the world. I wouldn't want a dog to, correcting for socialization aspects is fine. For obedience, that's not fine.
This next question is from Susan. What is the best way to address barking and jumping when someone comes to the door?
Okay, so this is the thing, Susan. Your dog should never jump on people. Bottom line, it's non-negotiable. I fix jumping in about 1 second. And maybe there's many ways to do it. This is what I don't want you to do. I do not want you to ignore it. That is the most dangerous advice given. Websites say it, books say it, dog trainers say it. I can't imagine more dangerous advice to suggest advice. But I know I hear it all the time. Clients come to me all the time and they say, my trainer or whatever told me to ignore jumping. Really? You've got to be kidding me. So a 40 to 100 pound dog, or even a smaller dog, is jumping on me. I am supposed to ignore it. My guests are supposed to ignore it. Absolutely not. Don't do it. This is how I fix jumping. Prong collar on the dog. 6-foot leash on the dog. Human walks in. I allow the dog, this is the fixed jumping. I allow the dog to walk up. The leash is loose. Do not hold dogs back. That creates agitation. Agitation is how we get dogs to be aggressive. Loose leash. Person walks in. Dog walks up. The dog tries to jump. You give a very firm pop. It's not mean. It's not abusive. A very firm pop. The dog might go, ow! Well, stop jumping. If you want to fix jumping, you need to have a high aversive. Anytime you want to eliminate a behavior, eliminate, you need to make a consequence that is high enough to get rid of it. Now, someone is going to say, I'm well aware of it, I can read too. No, teach the dog to sit. teaching a behavior, another behavior, does not eliminate the bad behavior. It does not. I'll tell you the story. I come home from work. My kids would never do this. I come home from work. Angelo, we all know Angelo, right? Angelo has a marker, a permanent marker. He's writing on my furniture with a permanent marker. I come home. Angelo, come outside. It's time to train the dogs. What does Angelo do? He stops writing on the couch. He runs to me. He wants to train the dogs. Okay. Does he learn not to draw on the couch? No, he doesn't. Now, I'm not going to give him a correction with a prong collar, remote collar. Of course not. The point is, you can never eliminate a bad behavior training a new behavior. It cannot be done. It won't stop the dog from jumping. So what do? You make it uncomfortable to jump. Bottom line, I do it every day. It's successful. It lasts a long time. Fine, once in a while you have to do it. There's no such thing as working on jumping. Okay? Your dog either jumps or doesn't jump. And to allow guests to train your dog, Dad, just eliminate, just don't pay attention to Max. If he jumps, ignore him. Oh, Dad, turn your back. Really? I'm going to let my 80-year-old father turn his back on a 70 or 80-pound German Shepherd dog? He's going to be kidding me. What happens if my dad gets scratched? What happens if my dad gets knocked over? These are happening. I care so much about humans and dogs that I will fix it in 1 second. Barking? Why is your dog barking? Dogs bark for a lot of reasons. But you want to stop your dog from barking? You've got to correct it. No, no, no. I can run my dog for 20 miles a day. It's still going to bark at someone at the door. So, barking, remote collar, quiet, pop. End of story. It's easy. It's simple. It's great for families. It's not mean. The dog won't be aggressive. The dog won't be afraid of the door. The dog won't be afraid of people coming in the door. Those are all lies.
Question from Tom. What did you mean by if the dog was off lead when they got into a fight? That they are now aggressive to dogs, can that be reversed?
Okay, what I meant was, thank you, Tom. I guess I didn't clarify. A lot of people think they've got aggressive dogs. A lot of people think they have aggressive dogs. Just because of the way it acts on a leash. To fully find out if a dog is actually aggressive, you have to do something. It has to be off leash with other dogs. It's the way it is. So a dog can be out of control on a leash. You can let it off leash, and it walks up to the dog and sniffs its butt, and it plays with it. Don't do that, please. Don't let out of control dogs off leash. That's not what I'm saying. But in order for us to find out if a dog is actually aggressive, is it actually getting into dog fights? And yes, it could be reversed. 90%+ of dogs that are getting into fights can actually stop fighting. Absolutely.
Okay, a question asking more about your thoughts. A trainer told us the reason that our pit became aggressive towards other dogs on walks is because she is protecting us from the other dogs because we are not protecting her.
Could be. I think it's deeper than that. But there's some truth to that. How's that? There's a little bit of truth to that. So. But I think it's bigger than that. I think it's your dog is probably acting aggressive because you never told it not to. How about that instead? Now, does your dog feel that you can't protect the pack? Maybe. Not enough leadership and guidance. There's so many reasons. There's probably 10 reasons why. How's that? That might be one of them.
Do you have a foolproof recall method?
Remote collar training. Absolutely. Remote collar training is close to 100%, in my opinion, as you can get. Is there other ways? Maybe. I don't train that way. Okay? I don't train that way. But for your average person, getting a rock-proof, bomb-proof, foolproof, if you mean that you're not a good dog trainer, have your dog remote collar trained and keep practicing it over and over again.
Let's keep the e-collar convo on. How do I decide what level I should put the e-collar on?
The dog always tells you. So the dog tells you. You want to find a working level? I've got a video on how to find a working level of a remote collar, which is the lowest level the dog feels. I do baseline training with the dog. And then I find, the dog tells me. The dog. Okay, here's a great idea. Here's a great example. There's working level and there's correction level. Okay? The working level is the lowest level the dog feels to get the dog to be motivated. So, let's say the dog knows down. Here's a great example. The dog knows down. You've done it 100 times. Down, the dog lies down. Down, the dog lies down. You say down. We're talking about a dog that knows down. The dog isn't down. You're on level 5. Boom, dog doesn't do it. 10, dog doesn't do it. 12, dog doesn't do it. 15. Dog goes into a down. 15 is the level. I don't know. The dog knows. Start out low. Advocate for your dog. Always advocate for your dog and then listen to your dog. And then listen to your dog. And this concept of, well, if you work the dog long enough and hard enough and enough times, he'll always listen to you, that's a lie. It's not true. Your dogs, they don't always listen. They just don't. You know? I think anybody that's in the real world, they don't always listen. I'm a family dog trainer. I'm not a competition dog trainer. And even competition dog trainers, the dog doesn't always listen. You can do 500 repetitions of something. The dog still doesn't always listen. So that's why I like remote collars. It's that little bit of a safety net that you have just in case. I got a will. In fact, I'm redoing my will this week. I've got a will. I've got life insurance. I wear a seatbelt. I got car insurance. I got health insurance. And I'm hoping I never have to use any of those things. But if I do, I got it there. It's a safety net. Remote collars are safety nets.
One more e-collar question. What age do you think it's appropriate to use an e-collar?
If you use it at a low level as an educational tool, you can start it as young as 14 weeks. I mean, it's actually less invasive than a leash. Think about that. You can pair it with food. You can do remote collar training along with food training. You can pair it. The remote collar is not a torture or correction device if you use it as just an advocate device. It's just pressure. So imagine this, guys. Ready? Young puppy, leash, food. Sit. Gently hold up the leash. Reward with food. If that's how you want to train it. Instead of using the leash, remote collar, pressure. It's all pressure, guys, right? It's all pressure. Remote collar. It's the same thing. It's the exact same thing. It's just pressure. And we look at pressure differently than dogs look at pressure.
Question from Tom. How do you stop a dog from being possessive of his owner?
Of his owner? Don't let him. Start creating space. Okay? So place him down far away, like 6 feet away, 10 feet away. Get them to hold the command, meet lots of people. Stop letting the dog do it. A lot of behaviors can change by just stopping the – don't let them do it. Just don't let him do it.
Do dogs learn when they have the e-collar on and when they don't?
Dogs learn all the time. Oh, okay, got it. But maybe like the dog only listens when the remote collar's on? Is that, do you think the flavor of that?
I'm thinking it's, does a dog, can a dog tell the sniffy has a, like an e-collar on or a flat collar on?
Yeah, I mean, dogs are very aware that the remote collar's on. But this is the thing. If you wake up in the morning and you put the remote collar on and then you take it off when you go to bed and you just work your dog, you're going to have yourself a trained dog. Halfway through the day, though, or every 4 hours, guys, take it from one side and do it on another side. E-collars do not burn. They don't burn. If anything, you can see, maybe see some pressure sores. It's not burning. There's no such thing as burning. It's not electricity.
Okay, this question's from Betsy on e-collars. Yeah. Topic of the day. How do you use the e-collar to discourage a dog from digging in the yard?
Okay, that's when you would do it as a correction. So there's a couple of things you can use it as a correction. So, dog digs, higher level. Dog digs, why? I'm making it uncomfortable for you to dig. Okay, dog goes to eat poop, higher level. It's all correction. Okay, when it comes to that stuff, you have to stop the behavior. You have to stop the behavior. So how high? The dog will let you know. Right? The dog goes to dig, correct. If the dog keeps digging, you didn't get it high enough. Let the dog know. Let the dog know. That's it. 1 o'clock. Guys, thank you so much. I'm honored. I feel blessed that you actually will participate in this, that you took time out of your day to actually ask me questions and to watch. I'm excited about the progress we're making with all the dogs. We've got a board, you're actually in my board and training facility. This is called the Rubber Room. I think this room is 3,500 square feet of about the 17,000 square feet space that we have here. We have a wonderful daycare for our dogs. We do overnight boarding. The boarding and the daycare is only for our clients. It's a private facility. We do a board and train. We also do one-on-one dog training. We specialize in dogs with some pretty serious issues. I love my puppies. I love basic obedience. But if you've got a dog with some severe separation anxiety, if you've got a dog with aggression or leash reactivity, we work with those dogs all the time. I love the fact that we can offer these free services to you. Don't forget this Saturday, it's the What Would Jeff Do radio show. It's on every Saturday morning from 9 to 11 Eastern Standard Time. You can actually watch it in this format, but you can also listen to it online. And then you can actually hear it in Rhode Island. Our radio show is heard in over 80 countries right now. And all that stuff will also be put up on iTunes and podcast. If you missed any part of this show, it will be up and available later today. I'll put it on Facebook, but it'll also be on my YouTube channel. Again, thank you guys so much. I am madly in love with you. I truly, truly am. I feel so fortunate that I can help so many people, so many dogs, and just, you know, keep doing what you're doing. I love the fact that you guys are working so hard. I know it's hard. It's challenging. It's challenging, and I can appreciate that. All right. Awesome. Thanks, guys.